Gautam, can you please put yourself on mute? Or I will just do that. All right. Okay, so hello guys, how are you all doing today? So can you hear me? Is the audio clear? Is everything cool? Can you hear me clear, right?
Gautam, can you please put yourself on mute?
All right, perfect. Great, theek hai. So let me just share my screen, and before that, I want to start a poll, okay? I want to understand that who we are talking to, right? Let's know each other, okay? So a poll is here. Please answer the questions. Hi, Manveer. Hello, hi, Lakshay. Great. So almost everyone has answered the questions. Please wrap it up. Okay. Cool. I think that is enough. I can share the results with you guys as well. Just give me 1 second. So out of the 500 people in the room, first of all, 234 people are the ones who are pursuing their bachelor's degree right now. Okay. And a very good percentage of the people have finished their 10 plus 2 diploma as of now. And 20% people have finished their bachelor's degree. And obviously 50%, almost 50% of the students want to go to their dream destination, Canada. And then there are people who are thinking of UK, USA, Australia, New Zealand. Nowadays, a lot of people don't think about it, obviously. And elsewhere, I believe elsewhere, it's Germany, most likely. Only 8% people have taken the IELTS, and 60% people are 100% sure about their study abroad plan. All right. Okay, great. So that means that I will be addressing this particular audience in a way that I am able to add the maximum value according to what you have just shared. All right. So Vishal, I will help you with that selection. No worries. Cool. So I will quickly share the agenda for the day. And after that, I will start my presentation, and then I will introduce the other panelists that I have with me and what they will be doing in this particular webinar. Okay. So welcome to this webinar on studying abroad. And the agenda that we have for the day is that, you know, whenever we used to have an event or whenever we used to have an offline event, how we used to start it is that we used to light a lamp. There used to be a proper lamp lighting ceremony and all those things. But nowadays it is more about, can you hear me, right? So I believe that I am audible. I believe that I am visible. Everything is clear, right? Next session is my session in which I am going to help you on how to choose a course, whether you're going to Canada, whether you're going to US, UK, anywhere. How do you choose a course? What should be those parameters that you should keep in mind? Then we will be having a webinar by Sanjita, who happens to be a British Council trained and certified IELTS trainer who has trained thousands of students. And then we have a session, an interactive Q&A session with Mr. Gautam, who happens to be someone, like, if to be very honest, if I had to give my file for visa filing, I would give it to him. He is very, very pro at it. He understands how to get the visas done, where to place the documents, where not to place the documents, what to do, how to justify the gap and all those things. So starting with my session on how to choose a course, which happens to be the most vital session, I must say, because you are going to invest a lot of money, right? You're going to invest lakhs of rupees into this. So let's just quickly start with that. So choosing a course, right? A lot of people don't really think about it. All they are about is visa, de do. But trust me over this, it is equally important to choose a good course. Okay. So how do you choose a course? First of all, little bit about us. So we represent more than 800 universities and colleges across US, UK and Canada. We are not currently working with Australia and New Zealand, but we are working with US, UK and Canada. Beyond that, there are more than 10,000 students who follow us in our emails, on our YouTube, on our Facebook page, etc. It's more than 11,000, I must say. And in the past 3 months itself, we have processed more than 100 visas, the Canadian study permits, and a couple of them for UK and US as well. Overall, we have a cumulative experience of 9 years when it comes to educational consultancy, education abroad, career counseling, and all those things. Moving on to what is the taxonomy of courses, right? So when you are studying here in India, what happens is that you finish your 10 plus 2 and then the very simple route is that you complete your bachelor's degree, right? But it's a bit different when you are thinking of studying abroad, particularly if you are thinking of studying in Canada, then these terms are extremely important that you should understand. And these terms, like if you will know them, then you will be able to talk to your consultant better, you will be able to talk to us better, you will be able to make better decisions, okay? So when a student completes his 10 plus 2, the next qualification that he can enter is a college certificate. Now, what is a college certificate? College certificate is a one year long certification course at a college. All right. And this particular certificate can be in a specific field, for example, office administration. It can be in a field like accounting. It can be in a field like something related to skills, right? Anything that is more skill oriented. Next comes college diploma. So once you complete your 10 plus 2, you can either go for a college certificate or a university certificate. Just put a slash instead, like with college. If you do not want to go for a 1 year course, you go for a college diploma. Or if you're going to a university, it becomes university diploma. Okay. After university diploma, there's a bachelor's degree. So just like a bachelor's degree here in India, there's a bachelor's degree there. So you do your bachelor's degree. After that, once you have completed your bachelor's degree, you can go for a graduate certificate. Okay. This is generally the course that is also known as a postgraduate diploma. This is what most of the people call it. So you can go for a graduate certificate after your bachelor's degree, after doing your bachelor's degree here in India. And you can also do a graduate certificate after completing your college diploma in Canada or somewhere else as well. We will talk about it in a while. Then finally, the last qualification is a master's degree. As far as PhDs are concerned, PhDs have an altogether different route. So you need to somewhat have a professor in a particular university who should be interested in supervising you over the research work that you want to pursue or that you want to do. So it's an altogether different ballgame. Right now, we will be limiting this discussion to master's degree, and the people who already have a master's degree, I know there are a lot of people here. For them, I will also tell what you can do, keeping Mr. Gautam in loop, because he knows after all how to get the visa. All right, moving on to the, just hold on a second, I'm facing a small issue. Just give me 1 second, guys. My Zoom hanged. All right. Now, finally, after you have understood that what are the different courses that are available that you can do abroad, let us understand that what should you be doing and who should opt for a college certificate or who should opt for a bachelor's degree, who should opt for a graduate certificate, etc. Okay. First of all, college certificate. honestly, no one should opt for it. The reason behind that is that it is a one-year course. After finishing your 10 plus 2, if you opt for a college certificate, the chances of a visa are bleak. Okay, it is never recommended that you opt for a one-year course after completing your 10 plus 2, not at all. So according to us, no one should be looking at college certificates. Okay, the second option is college diploma. So if you are someone who has finished your 10 plus 2 here in India, or you are someone who has finished a diploma. So there are a lot of candidates who go for a diploma after their 10th class, right? So the 3 years technical school diploma. So if you are someone who has done that, then you should be going for a college diploma itself. In India, after finishing a diploma, you get admission in the second year of bachelor's of engineering, but it is not the case in Canada. If you want to go for a bachelor's degree, you will have to start it from the first year itself, or the second option is to go for a college diploma. Finally, the bachelor's degree is obviously opted by students who have completed their 10 plus 2. And as I just mentioned, if you have completed your diploma here in India. Now, graduate certificate. If you are someone who has completed a bachelor's degree in India or who has completed a master's degree in India, I have put this in underline. There's a reason behind that. The reason behind that is that it is quite conditional. Okay. For example, if you are someone who already has a very good master's degree and then you're going for a graduate certificate, there's a very good chance of visa rejection. Okay. So we need to plan your postgraduate certificate in such a way that it is relevant to your career goals. It is relevant to what your plans are, what you have done before, what your previous education is. And you have to, you know, justify all of this in a letter of motivation that you attach with the visa file that you are sending. Then finally, master's degree. So all the people who are, you know, currently in their bachelor's must be looking at a master's degree abroad. There are a lot of people who must be, who must have, you know, got some 3 or 4 years of work experience, 2 years of work experience. They might be looking at a master's degree abroad. All right. So if you have a bachelor's degree, you can go for a master's. And if you have a master's degree, you can also go for a double master's, provided that you can convince the visa officer about it, provided that you have a clear-cut goal about it, that why do you want to do that particular master's degree. All right, moving on to, one second, let me clear this. All right, moving on to difference between a college diploma and a bachelor. So, you know, as you have understood here that there's a college certificate and a college diploma and college bachelor's degree. We have already recommended that you should not go for a college certificate at all. So now the two options are after 10 plus 2, college diploma and bachelor's degree. Now the question is, sir, which one should I choose? Should I choose a college diploma or should I choose a bachelor's degree? So let's look at what both of these are. What is the significance of them? This is in context of Canada. Okay. This is in context of Canada. As far as US and UK are concerned, you should go for a bachelor's degree only. It's like the bachelor's degrees are quite good there. It is worth going for a bachelor's degree if you are considering US and UK. And I don't believe that a lot of universities offer diplomas anyway, right? So you should be going for a bachelor's degree in US and in UK. And for Canada, let's look at the difference between a college diploma and a bachelor's degree. First of all, a college diploma is something that focuses on practical knowledge, right? Skills oriented training. What I mean by that, you will find a college diploma in blockchain development. Okay. You will find a college diploma in, let's say business marketing. You will find a college diploma in general business management. Okay. College diplomas generally train you on a particular skill, on a particular trade, so that you are employable as soon as you finish your education. Bachelor's degree are more like theoretical and they have in-depth knowledge. And now bachelor's degrees are also focusing on equal like jobs and skill training. That's obviously bachelor's degree have their own charm. But as far as a difference is concerned, if you are someone who does not plan to do a lot in academics, if you are someone who wants that, okay, I just want to move to a new country, I want to complete a course, hunt for a good job, start working. If you want to get into the workforce quick, college diploma should be your choice. If you are someone who thinks that I want to do a bachelor's, then a master's, or let's say that I want to do something in academics, I want to excel in the field of academia, then you should definitely be thinking of a bachelor's degree. Now, college diplomas, the fee is inexpensive. Okay, it's not at all expensive to afford pursuing a college diploma after your 10 plus 2. But if you have a bachelor's, if you want to go for a bachelor's degree, they are expensive. And one very important thing, college diplomas are generally 1 or 2 years long. Let's say 2 years long. Bachelor's degrees are at least 3 or 4 years long. Okay, so you have to keep in mind that you have to plan an investment of 70,000 to 1 lakh Canadian dollars for your bachelor's degree, or on a bare minimum plan at least 60,000 to 80,000 dollars. In case of a college diploma, you need to plan 25,000 to 30,000 dollars. That's it, right? After completing your college diploma, you can also go for a graduate certificate. Okay, so what was a graduate certificate? Graduate certificate came here after a bachelor's degree. If you have done a bachelor's degree here in India, you can go for a graduate certificate. But if you have a Canadian college diploma, there are many graduate certificates that you can go for. Okay, so this is something that you can do, but you cannot go for a master's degree if you have a college diploma. Okay, if you have a bachelor's degree from a Canadian institute, only then you can think of going for a master's. Otherwise, you cannot think of doing a master's degree. All right. As far as the postgraduate work permit is concerned, we will talk about it in a bit. What is it? And we will come back to this slide later on. All right. Moving on to difference between graduate certificate and master's. So now addressing most of the people in this room. There, like, I created a WhatsApp group that already has almost 200 students. You know, I'm answering their queries as and when I'm available. The biggest query was, sir, postgraduate diploma or master's degree, what should I choose, right? That what should be the choice, postgraduate diploma or master's degree? There are a lot of chat messages currently. Give me 1 second. Guys, I will be able to address your chats in a bit. Okay, by the time Gautam is replying, cool, right? So as far as the difference between a postgraduate diploma and a master's degree is concerned, that what should you choose after your bachelor's degree? First of all, graduate certificate is more or less like a college diploma. It focuses on skills, right? So for example, there are a lot of postgraduate diplomas in digital media marketing, in big data solutions architecture, to become a business analyst, to become, let's say, a business administrator, okay, to focus on filmmaking. So they are more focused on skills, the things that are in demand right now, the things that you can find on YouTube, etc., right? So you can easily focus on that. So there's this comment by Nikhil. So there's this guy, Nikhil Bansal, saying that agar daily ke 6,000 se 10,000 kamane hain, to mujhe batao, to MLM wale kahin bhi har jagah pahunch jate hain. So I would request Nikhil to please leave this webinar. This is not a place for you, buddy. Please. So I would suggest that, you know, there are many other places where you can go. Okay. Yes, sure. We can apply after 10 plus 2. I will come after this. You know, I will come to doubts after a while. All right, cool. So moving on to the difference between a postgraduate diploma and a master's degree, right? So first of all, you have to focus, like, the focus is on skills as far as postgraduate diplomas are concerned. Master's degree are also focused on jobs, but there is a catch, okay? Master's degrees, generally, you get an admission from a university only if you have 73% and above and a good academic track record. If you have more than 3 or 4 or 5 backlogs, then it is very difficult for you to get a master's degree. I will be honest. All right. It's very difficult. And even if you will get a master's degree, it will be from a university which is not really worth doing a master's degree from. Okay. So rather than spending $30,000 a year on a master's degree that is not really worth it, I would suggest go for a postgraduate diploma from a good college. All right. So this is a formula that you should have in mind. And second thing, if you have a good track record and you can afford, go for master's degree for sure. All right. Then a good master's degree is 100% better than a postgraduate diploma. But if you do not have 73% or above in your bachelor's degree, then it will be a bit difficult. All right. So now, obviously, the fee difference is quite prominent. It's like the master's degrees are generally twice expensive as that of bachelor's degrees. Also, although there are some masters that are inexpensive as well, the postgraduate diplomas are very easy to get into, right? But master's degree is going to require some academic excellence and good track record from your end, right? At your end. Most of the people whose agenda is, I just want to settle down in a different country, okay? That I want PR and I want to start my life a different way. Then postgraduate diplomas or graduate certificates are the way forward. Okay, then it is the way forward. And so there are people talking about scholarships as well. So I will also, discuss that, what's the criteria for scholarships. I have some information about that as well. And second thing is that if you're someone who is really focused on career, and if you're someone focused on career, then definitely you would be having a good percentage as well. Right. So in the Chetna, IELTS indicator is not at all useful for your visa. Word over. Right. We tweeted to IRCC and they have replied back that IELTS indicator or Duolingo are not relevant for visa. Okay. IELTS indicator is just relevant for your college admission. So you can take Duolingo test instead of IELTS indicator for your visa. For your college admission. It's easier than IELTS indicator. Right. So if you're eligible for a master's, go for a master's. But if you think that this is not the criteria that you can match, then I would recommend going for a graduate certificate. So the person who is asking about, sir, can I go to Canada after 12th? Yes, we discussed that here elaborately. The recording of this webinar will be available on YouTube. And I will send a link of this on the email IDs as well. And no, not 73%, not in 12th, in your bachelor's. Now you're going for a master's degree, na? So they will be looking at your bachelor's percentage, not your 10 plus 2 percentage. Okay, cool. Moving on to something very important, that is postgraduate work permit. Okay, so what does this mean? This basically means that once you complete your education, you will get to stay in Canada to look for jobs or to work without any condition. Okay, so that's how it is. And but there's a very, very, very important catch here. And particularly the people who are from Punjab here and Gujarat here, there are a lot of consultants who recommend colleges that do not offer postgraduate work permit. Okay, we will talk about co-op as well, Mohammed. All right, so they do not offer postgraduate work permit. Okay, it is very important that whenever a consultant is recommending you a college or whenever you are looking for courses yourself, always verify that whether that institute is offering PGWP or not. And how do you do that? Let's open Google. Let's do a quick Google search, DLI list. Okay, once you open the first link, right, this is the official website, canada.ca. Always verify whether an institute has a DLI number. And if it has a DLI number, then you should check whether it offers PGWP eligible programs as well. So, you know, most like this is something really bad, but what happens is, so sometimes consultants share screenshots till here. Okay. They won't show you the next tab. They will just share the screenshot till here that this institute has a DLI number. Okay. But you have to look at this column as well. All right. They are clearly mentioning which institute has a postgraduate work permit programs, has postgraduate work permit programs, and they are clearly telling which do not. Okay. So let us do a quick, demo. So there's this institute, Toronto School of Management. All right, Toronto School of Management. Now, I had a case in which there was this student who studied here, and then later on, he got to know that this institute doesn't have PGWP, and he got to know when he finished his education there, right? So Toronto School of Management, right? Clearly mentioned that it doesn't offer PGWP. So you have to stay away from this. Okay. No, if it doesn't offer PGWP, bye bye. Then let's look at a college, let's say Georgian College, okay, a very famous college across Canada, in Canada, and you know, most of the students opt for it as well. Offers PGWP program, yes, all right, easy, cool. So it's like, this is something that you should always keep in mind whenever you are thinking of you know, applying for your PGWP. Harsimrat Northwest College in Alberta has PGWP 100%. We have also sent a few students there. You can check here, right? Northwest College, all the campuses have PGWP eligible programs. Okay. At the same time, there are some colleges and universities which have some programs eligible for Vishal Centennial College is one of the oldest and the one of the most reputed colleges in Canada. It has PGWP eligibility, not an issue. You need not worry about that. Okay. Now talking about an institute in which some of the courses have PGWP eligibility, some of the courses don't have PGWP eligibility. Akashti, PGWP is postgraduate work permit. It means that once you graduate, you get to stay in Canada to work, to accumulate some Canadian work experience that helps you in your PR application. Okay. So if you do not go to an institute which offers PGWP, getting a PR in Canada is very difficult. It's next to impossible. You will have to spend a lot of money on some illegal channels, in some illegal channels. So I would suggest staying away from that. All right. Now let's say there's this university, Canada West. Here you can see that offers PGWP programs, yes, but then details. Okay. Ruchika, I just mentioned PGWP means that you get to stay in Canada after completing your education to work and to accumulate work experience. That's how it is. All right. And you, like here, when I clicked on details, it has mentioned that if you complete only one of these degrees from this institute, you will be getting a PGWP postgraduate work permit. You will be getting to stay in Canada. You can call it the stay back period to make it easier for you. All right. So we will come to the other countries in our Q&A session. Just wait, hold on, have patience. I would recommend you guys to just listen for now and I will clear all your queries. All right. To be very honest, I cannot even read the messages. They are so fast. Cool. So try to understand that. All right. Coming back to my presentation. So this is something that was about postgraduate work permit. Now, if you do a 1 year course, you get 1 year postgraduate work permit. So obviously the people who are going after their bachelor's degree, only they get to choose between a 1 year course and a 2 years course. So if you're going for a 1 year course, you will get 1 year PGWP. If you will go for a 2 years course or a 16 months course, you will get a 3 years postgraduate work permit. Okay. Now there's this puzzle as well. All right. A lot of students ask that, sir, my course is only 16 months long. Will I get 3 years work permit or will I get 16 months work permit or less than 3 years? All right. See, in Canada, 1 year has two terms. All right. When you complete two terms, it becomes 1 year. Okay. Yes, Mirza, Canada College has PGWP. Don't worry. And one term is 4 months. So when you complete your education in 8 months, you complete two terms. Okay. So when 1 year has two terms, you have completed 1 year of education. Okay. So even if you're going for an 8 months course, you get 1 year of postgraduate work permit. Okay. So you don't have to worry about it. You will easily get the work permit, even if you complete 8 months of work permit. Jinesha, it's canada.ca. All right. And you can verify this information on the link that is given here. I will email you this PDF later on so you can verify it there. All right. Moving on to scholarships. I know a lot of people ask about it, that, you know, what are the scholarship options available, etc., etc. So let's quickly talk about what are some scholarships that are scholarship options that are available. So first of all, the first option is that you can go for some external funding agencies, right? There are some third party scholarship organizations. Okay. And then you have the scholarships that are offered by the college or the university where you are studying. Okay. There are two types of There are two places from where you can get a scholarship. First is, there are some organizations, agencies that offer scholarships. Second is the college or the university where you are applying. All right. Now, talking about these external funding agencies, there are a lot of government as well as non-government organizations that we are not aware of. Okay. I have prepared a document here and I will send it to you guys. Let me just show that document to you. So I will send this to you, send it to you guys, right? So it has a list of organizations that generally provide scholarships for studying abroad. And this is specifically for Canada, right? Because a lot of people want to go there. So you can get in touch with these organizations. You will get an email with this. So with this document, so you can get in touch with these organizations and know more about it. Okay. And now let me tell you about some community specific scholarships. All right. A lot of people are not aware of this, but let's take an example. There's this student of ours who happens to be from Andhra Pradesh and he belongs to Kapu community. Now, this Kapu community has a scholarship in which they sponsor students to go and study abroad, in which they pay the full tuition fee, they pay the full living expense, everything. Okay. Now, as far as this is, Nandana, we will come to that. Now, as far as this is concerned, talk to your grandfather, talk to your father, talk to your, you know, people who are senior in your community. They must be aware of that. In many times, we are never ever aware, you know, that we have an opportunity for us that can help us sponsor our education. Do a quick Google search. You will be able to find a lot of options like these. All right. Then obviously the college and the university, the schools and the universities have their scholarship where you have studied from. Okay. So for example, there are some very good schools in India. If you are an alumni, you can write to them that I have an admission from this university. Can you please give me a scholarship, right? So they are able to do that easily. All right. It is not a problem at all. Okay. Try to do that. Then finally, state governments have their own scholarship programs. You need to hunt. You need to look for it on Google. The main idea is that I can only give you the direction. It based on your case, based on your own personal circumstances, you will have to find the correct path. Okay. Then mama, papa, chacha, chachi, mamu, mami, dada, dadi, nana, nani, right? They are always there to sponsor us. They're always there to, you know, PFPF hota hai hamare ghar walon ka. So let's get it invested in the right way at the right place. Okay. Waste nahi karna. In sab cheezon ko dhyan mein rakke, is sabhi cheezon ko acche se samajh ke mujhe kya karna chahiye, kyun karna chahiye, main jis course mein ja raha hu wo mere ko PGWP dega nahi dega, in sabhi cheezon ko consider karte hue aapko decision lena hai, taki agar aap mamma papa chacha chachi se help le rahe ho, make sure that unki investment sahi jagah lage. All right. Okay. So sorry. I will talk in English now. I got emotional when we were talking about family, no? All right. Now it is very, you know, as I was telling you that there are two ways to get scholarships. First is external fundings and second is college/university. Okay. So as far as college/university is concerned, it is very rare that a college diploma or a graduate certificate would happen on the basis of a scholarship. Rare. Okay. Most of the colleges and, you know, if you're going for a college diploma or let's say a graduate certificate, these two courses, this or this, then forget a scholarship. You might have to plan it on your own, right? Let's not waste the time. Cool. Finally, if you are going for a bachelor's or a master's degree, good chance, very good chance, get a good score in IELTS. The next session is about how to crack IELTS. Okay. The next session is about how to crack IELTS. Khushi, absolutely. You can get an education loan. I will tell you some conditions about education loan as well. 2 minutes. Let me finish my presentation. So as far as the bachelor's and master's degrees are concerned, yes, you can easily get a scholarship. Try to, you know, have a good, if you're already in your bachelor's degree and if you have a good CGPA, let's say 7.58, try to wrap your bachelor's around 8.5 or 9. Perhaps try to push it above 8.5 and publish 2 or 3 good research papers. Okay. Already start shortlisting the university. Once you have shortlisted the university, try to find out that who is the dean there. Okay. Now look at what area or what field of interest is your dean doing research in. Publish a research paper in that field of interest. Okay. Then write an email to your dean, to the prospective university, that, sir, I have done this research. After going through your work, I really want to work under you. That dean would be more than happy that, okay, I am getting this funding approved for you. You come, right? That he will love you. But we don't do all these things, right? We don't even know how to do these things or how to make these things happen, because no one has told us as of now. That's the whole problem. That was the problem with me as well when I wanted to go for my master's degree, right? So this is something that you should keep in mind. And if you do not get a pre-admission scholarship, that means that there are some scholarships that, you know, you do not get before you pay the tuition fee. Go to the college, perform well there, and there are many times that the students get their tuition fee back. Okay. If you are able to get a very good score in your, you know, good CGPA in the course that you are pursuing. All right. So there's a very important question here about finance education loan, right? Let's talk about education loan. Everyone listen to me carefully. There are two ways through which you can get an education loan: collateral / non-collateral. Okay. Easy. Collateral means kuch girvi rakhna padta hai, you have to collateralize something, and non-collateral means that you just get it on the basis of your credentials. Government banks in India do not offer non-collateralized loan above rupees 7.5 lakh for overseas education. Repeat, 7.5 lakhs is the maximum amount that you can get as a non-collateralized loan from a government bank. Private organizations give loans up to as much amount as possible without collateral. There are some organizations like Avance, which specifically deals with students who want to study abroad. There are organizations like HDFC Credila, right? So you can approach them based on the profile that you have. You can get it, right? And in most of the cases, like particularly HDFC Credila, we have dealt with them. If a student has a very good IELTS score, they give it without collateral up to 60 lakhs. All right. And every loan has interest. So one of the candidates is asking that every loan has does education loan have interest? Yes, there is no loan without interest. Okay. It doesn't work like that. All right. So moving on to, yeah, IELTS is for everywhere. IELTS is for US, UK, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, anywhere you want to go, you have to, you can show IELTS to the college, to the embassy, everywhere. All right. In all countries. Yeah. Cool. Moving on to a very important concept known as a co-op. Okay. So all the people who are currently in their bachelor's degree and the people who are thinking of doing college diplomas, listen to me carefully. This is very important. Okay. Whenever you complete a degree in a foreign country and you look for jobs, one thing very important is that, let's say you have completed a course from Canada, the employer would ask for Canadian experience before giving you a job. If you have completed it from UK, the employer would ask for experience in the UK. If you have completed it from US, right, obviously this is something very DNPTE is accepted in Canada, but the rejection rates are very high. So you need to ask the PTE people to send your result directly to IRCC. Only then, and even then, the chances are bleak. I would recommend take IELTS. Do not, risk your application and your money and all those things. Cool. All right. Your Indian experience has no value. Okay. Your Indian experience has no value when you go there. No one is going to even give a damn about what you have done here in India or anywhere else. Cool. So if you do not have experience, Canadian experience, and your Indian experience is not valued, how do you get into the job market? Co-op is a very great tool that allows you to get into a 4 months or an 8 months paid internship in which you get a full-time salary. Just say in India, what happens is, no, Saloni, this is more than an internship. In India, what happens is that, let's say, Master G is saying China ne corona ki vaccine bana li hai. So, okay. Chalo, bahut bahut mubarak hai aapko, but please don't waste our time. Go away. You can leave the webinar. All right. As far as the co-op is concerned, so co-op allows you to complete 2 terms or 1 term of paid work experience at a company, and this gets added to your Canadian work experience when looking for jobs. And in most of the cases, this co-op gets converted into a full-time job. There's a small difference between internship and co-op. Co-op is always paid. And when I say paid, it is full-time. Okay. So full-time pay. So in India, what happens is that if the salary of a full-time employee is 50,000, an intern gets 5,000. But in case of Canada, you get full salary in co-op, perhaps 10 or 15% less. That to just discuss the taxes. Okay. I have like someone who's asking what is co-op right in front of you. Look at the screen. It is written what is co-op. Okay. Okay. Moving on to 3 magic tools. Whether you are thinking of going to US, UK, Canada, New Zealand, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Saudi Arabia, Dubai, anywhere, doesn't matter. These 3 magic tools should be used. Yes, Rujita, in UK, it is known as a practicum. Okay. So anyway, LinkedIn, Indeed, and Facebook groups. LinkedIn, Indeed, Facebook groups. Hanji, how do you use them? Okay. Just hold on a second. Okay, so how is co-op different from a job? In case of a co-op, there is no obligation from the employer to continue your employment. Okay, co-op is for a limited period. Once you complete your co-op, it is based on your performance whether they give you a full-time job or not. That is the difference between a co-op and a full-time job. Cool. We have no idea about South Korea. Apologies. Okay, so Indeed, LinkedIn, and Facebook groups. Now, how do you do that? Okay, let's say you get in touch with us. Let's say you get in touch with another consultant. Let's say you are doing your own research. Okay, go on LinkedIn and try to find out the people who are completing this course or who have completed this particular course that you have shortlisted. Okay, there's a nice tool by LinkedIn, LinkedIn Premium. You can get its first month trial for free that allows you to send messages to anyone and everyone. Okay, get free LinkedIn Premium for a month. Message that person that, sir, I am interested in pursuing this course that you have pursued. Can you please give me a review? And always give specific points, right? Do not say that, sir, how is the course? Bhai, kya pata how is the course, right? No one has the answer, how is the course? For some, the course is good. For some, the course is bad. So try to be specific. Sir, how are the professors? Sir, can I manage part-time jobs with that? Sir, would it be easy to finish this course if I have this much CGPA? Sir, what are the job opportunities? Blah, 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 right? Sir, what was the co-op percentage? That how many students got a co-op after completing the course? Ask such questions and you will know whether that course is good or not. Second thing, Indeed. Indeed is the Naukri.com of India. Let's say that in India, it's Naukri.com. Indeed is in Canada. If you are thinking of going for a course in business, let's say you want to do a course of business analyst, right? Go on Indeed and search that, is there a demand of business analysts, right? Consultant bol dega, bahut demand hai, dollar ho jayenge, balle balle, right? But that is not the case, right? Do your own research. You are spending lakhs of rupees. Trust me, you know, in most, like when I went for the education, I knew that I'm spending all the life savings that I have of my parents. You are taking such a big risk. You are taking, you know, making such a big investment. Do the research. Do this. See, is business analyst in demand? Are there many job vacancies available for a business analyst? Done. If you find it, second factor, tick. Try to find out Facebook groups. Akshay, yeah, advanced diploma, PGWP, PGDM. Yes, there are many advanced diplomas in management, but it is advisable that you go for an advanced diploma in a technical field. For PGD, for in management, you can simply go for a normal college diploma of 2 years. Try to find out Facebook groups of your alumni. If you want to go for a particular course, try to find out Facebook groups of that course. Let's say if you're going to University ABC, just go on Google, Facebook, and search for University ABC BAT. This should be your exact keyword. University ABC batch. You will find a lot of batches. University ABC batch 2020, University ABC batch 2021, University ABC batch 2022, right? Join that group, post a message that I am thinking of joining this course. Can my seniors please give me an advice? Trust me, if I get a message like this, I always reply. It gives me instant gratification. It makes me feel happy that I have helped someone, right? So the other person would be interested in helping you as well. Okay. Finally, I will be opening for question and answers in 2 minutes, but I won't be able to answer all. The next session is on a very important topic, because whatever I have talked about is nothing without clearing IELTS. Okay. So till the time you don't get a good score in your IELTS test, it's all null and void. Cool. So the next session would be taken by Sanjita on IELTS preparation. But before that, if you want to have a consultation with us, if you want to have a consultation with me, then this is the number that is given on the, like the number that is given on the screen, US, UK, Canada. We have courses in all the three countries. So just, you know, send me a WhatsApp message preferably. And in the WhatsApp message, mention your name, your date of birth, what you have done already, your work experience, any education gap. Try to mention all those things. I will arrange a counseling with you. Okay. So that will somewhat help you in making some wiser and better decisions. Cool. So now I am open for queries. Yes, it will be free. It will be absolutely free. So quick, any queries related to courses? I will not be able to answer all. Whatever I will see, I will answer. How can we get the presentation? I will send it as an email. Is data science good? Data science is absolutely good. It is one of the most in-demand courses right now. Admission in MBA without GMAT. There are a lot of universities that offer MBA without GMAT. In fact, today on our YouTube channel, Glide by Preppy, we have posted an interview of a student who has completed an MBA from Canada and which happens without GMAT. Supply chain management is a very good course to do in Canada. Always go for a course with a co-op so that you get a good internship somewhere. And oh my God, hotel management, culinary management, in-demand courses, always hot. Social work, I would recommend to rethink. Okay. It's a good course, but it's good if you do for a, if you go for a master's of social work. I have seen a lot of students struggling who have gone for undergraduate courses in social work. And what about SOP? SOP is something that you need to write, particularly if you're looking at university admission. So there are a lot of messages. I cannot see anything now. Okay, wait. Let me just have a glass, have some water as well. Okay. I think that right now I seriously cannot look at the messages. Right, you know, I cannot read a single message. So I would recommend you to send me a WhatsApp message on the number that is given on the screen. In the next 24 hours, you will get your answer. Okay, apologies. I was unable to address it.
Pass the baton to me.
Yeah, right. So now the next session would be taken by...
Just cover a scholarship part, because people have queries regarding scholarship, okay. How they will get it, what is the basic criteria.
Okay.
Just tell them before you pass on to Sanjita.
All right. As far as scholarships are concerned, to be very honest, a lot depends upon your CGPA and your research work. Now in India, there's, you know, not this trend of doing a lot of research work, particularly in your bachelor's. Okay. So you should look at it. So there were a lot, almost 50% of the students in the class are the ones who are pursuing their bachelor's. Good time to wake up. Okay. Start publishing research papers. Start doing that. Nandini, if you're going for a college diploma, very difficult to get a scholarship. If you're going for a bachelor's, get good bands in IELTS. Try to get 7.5, 8 or 8.5. And if you have 90, 95, 90, like, you know, percentage like this, you might get a good percentage, good scholarship option for sure. All right. Co-op. Galaxy, I talked about co-op. Co-op is basically a 4 or 8 months paid internship at an institute. At a company which gets added to your Canadian work experience, which helps you get jobs later on. The co-op is generally arranged by the college. Okay. So it becomes easier for you to look for jobs. All right. So the people who I was unable to reply, who I was unable to message, I am sorry. So now I am passing on this session to Sanjita, who will be talking about how to crack IELTS. Trust me over this. When I prepared for IELTS on my own, I took help from Sanjita. Okay. And I have an 8.5 band score, I must tell you all. Right. So, okay, Sanjita. So the session is all yours. Thank you.
All right, Harit, could you please let me share my screen? I mean, I don't have that option yet. Sure. So just do that. All right, everyone. It's been 50 minutes of huge chunks of information that have been passed on to you, right from the different kinds of courses and the scholarship options that you have. So all of that would be possible only if you get your IELTS PAN scores, the right amount of IELTS PAN scores. So this particular session is going to be a very basic session about IELTS, because as the polls that were conducted in the beginning, they suggested that almost more than 50% of the students do not know what the IELTS test is all about. They're not sure about the format and there are some confusions about it. So we'll be discussing that. And one disclaimer before I get started is that while you're typing in the chat box regarding your doubts or queries, please ensure that if somebody else has already typed a similar doubt, do not type it again, because I'll miss out on those. So please be very streamlined. If you see that somebody else has already asked a similar question on a similar topic, then I'll elaborate that topic. That's my duty. Don't write your questions back to back, because that is really difficult to track on the screen. And that is what was the problem when Harit was taking the questions, or also when Gautam was trying to type and tell you the answers to all of them. So please be patient when it comes to that. All right. Okay, so let's start sharing. Okay, guys, can you see my screen? Fine, so IELTS to get those bank scores, and let me introduce myself. So my name is Sanjita and I'm a certified IELTS trainer by the British Council. And apart from that, I'm also a Canadian PR. So I have scored more than 8777. I've scored an overall bank score of 8.5 myself. So you can trust whatever is coming out of my mouth, because I've gone through the experience that you will be going through very soon. Okay, so let's get started with IELTS. So IELTS stands for International English Language Testing System. And here you need to understand that this test is conducted because of certain reasons. And I would like you guys to just type that reason. Why do you think IELTS test is conducted, or why do you think students have to take the IELTS test before they go abroad for their higher studies? Any reason, kya ho sakta hai reason, kyun hume IELTS test dena pad raha hai? Okay, I can't see the chat, one second. All right. Okay, to increase our way of speaking, to communicate, to check our English proficiency. All right, close enough. Okay, so the reason why they're asking you to take the IELTS test or any similar test to check your language proficiency skills is to see whether you can sustain in an English speaking country. Once you move abroad, once you go from India to any other country in the world where the most common language that's spoken, or perhaps the official language of that country, is English, will you be able to survive there? Can you manage your day-to-day activities and day-to-day communication there? So that's the only purpose. Okay, if you're studying there, you also need to know English so that you can write your assignments, you can speak and communicate to your teachers, your lecturers, your fellow students, and to the general public whenever you're going to a shop, to a grocery store. So that's the purpose. So whenever you're preparing for any test, you need to understand what's the purpose behind taking that test. What is going to be the benefit of preparing for English or for the IELTS test? So this is the benefit. It's not just to get to that country. It's also going to help you in the long run if you prepare in the right manner. So before I go ahead, a little about us. So these are the testimonials that you see on the right side, the success stories and the students who have cleared the IELTS test with flying colors after taking classes from us. On to your left is a little bit of story or information about us. So we started about 3 years ago and we've been training students from more than 30 countries across the globe, US, Canada, India, Saudi Arabia, UAE, and Ecuador, and Australia, New Zealand, of course. So these are the countries and many more that we have been teaching. I mean, the students of these countries have been taught by us. Apart from that, we have a huge subscriber base of about more than 45,000 on our YouTube channel. And we have given one-to-one courses to more than 2,000 students. And our team is a very trained team in which we ensure that each of our trainers are certified by the British Council or the IDP. And apart from that, they also have a teaching experience of at least 2 years. Okay, so that they can help you out and they can let you prepare better, guide you in the right direction. So this is a little about us. Moving ahead. Okay, this is done. You guys know British Council is one of the owner and partnering companies that conducts the IELTS test. And then somebody I read in the chat box wanted to know what kind of IELTS test or which type of IELTS test should be taken by a student. So there are two kinds of IELTS test. One's called the general training, the other one's called the IELTS academic. And the general training is something that is of concern to the people who want to get their PR or permanent residency for a particular country, or they're going for some professional purposes. However, the academic test is for each one of you who are watching us right now, who are in the webinar, because the academic test is for the ones who want to study abroad. So the name suggests in itself that it's going to be an academic test. Okay, any questions so far? Yeah, which type of IELTS should we take for visa and admission purposes? You have to take the IELTS academic, perfect. Okay. All right, the 50 messages.
Just hold on a second. Karan is asking this again and again. How can we crack IELTS in today's scenario? Karan, I took my IELTS on 2nd of August. I got my result. So IELTS is happening. You need not worry about it. IELTS is happening without any issues. So to all the people who think that IELTS has stopped, no, it has started happening in most of the places. And yes, US, UK, Canada, Australia, anywhere in the world, IELTS is required. IELTS is happening.
Harit, some of the students are asking about our YouTube channel for IELTS. Could you please attach the link
guys,
in the chat box?
You will get a long email with all the documents, with our YouTube channels and everything. Okay, so just have patience and attend the session right now.
Okay, fine. So here's a test overview for all the beginners who have no idea about what the IELTS test is. So there are four sections. There are four skills on which you will be assessed on. The skills are listening, reading, writing, and speaking. So these are the skills that would be utilized on a day-to-day basis once you move abroad as well. So you'll listen to a stranger, you'll listen to anyone who's talking to you, and then you'll have to answer them back by speaking. So listening and speaking are very vital to have a conversation. Apart from that, reading and writing are of utmost importance as you're going as a student. You're not going as a PR, you're going there to study. So if you're going there to study, you'll have to read a lot of books, you'll have to read a lot of research papers or text online. And that's where this academic reading is going to help you out. So when you're taking the test, when you're preparing for this IELTS test, imagine that you're preparing for some exam while you're sitting in Canada. And that's the amount of dedication that's needed while you're doing this. So understand how this preparation, this tiny preparation of about 1 month, would help you out in the long run for all the semester exams, for all the assignments, for all the papers that you'll be writing and submitting. So academic reading, you'll read, and then you will type your essays and your papers and you'll submit your tests. So that's how this is very crucial when it comes to your studying abroad. Okay, the system there is slightly different than what it is there in India. So they don't have exams like we do. I mean, they have exams, but they also have a lot of assignments that you have to be, that you have to submit on a regular basis so that you get assessed on a weekly or fortnightly basis. So this is where these two things would really come in handy. So listening and speaking for your generic purposes and reading and writing for your college. So basically, that's the purpose. Now, when it comes to your listening section, this is the first test that will be conducted on the IELTS test date. It's for about 30 minutes. There are four sections and there are 40 questions that are asked in those 30 minutes. And you'll have to complete that test within 30 minutes. The next test on the same day is your reading. It's for 60 minutes, which is 1 hour. There are three sections here, and yet again, there are 40 questions. So you have to complete those 40 questions within 1 hour. So you need to have good reading speed so that you can comprehend well and read at a fast pace so that you can complete all 40 questions within that time period. What about writing? Writing has two tasks. The first one is report writing, in which they'll give you some illustration, some diagram, pie chart, or some flow chart, table, or a graph, bar graph, or line graph. And you have to interpret that and write it in your own words, expressing good amount of English. The task two that you have is essay writing. So here you'll be given a topic and you have to talk on that topic. I mean, you have to write on that topic for about 250 words. So the task one is for 150 words. The task two is for 250 words. And it has to be completed in 1 hour. All right. Speaking usually is conducted on a different day from these three tests. Listening, reading, and writing is conducted on the same day, whereas speaking is conducted on a different day. And usually these days, if you're taking the computer delivered test, then nowadays they've started taking speaking on the same day as well. So here there's a lot of subjectivity, depends upon which date you get. So speaking could be or could not be on the same day. All right, this is general training. I'm not discussing this. This is just here for your own knowledge, just so that you understand there are various types of tests. However, the ones marked in red are what you need to focus on: listening, academic reading, academic writing, and speaking. Now, speaking is for about 11 to 14 minutes. It's face-to-face communication between the examiner and the student or the candidate, which would be you guys, and you have to answer the questions that are put forward by the IELTS examiner, and they'll be assessing you, they'll be recording what you say. And the speaking test is divided into three parts. The first one is basically kind of an introductory round where they'll ask you general familiar questions about your work life, about your school life or your college life. And then second part, or the part two, is basically a cue card round in which the examiner will ask you certain questions, will give you a cue card and ask you questions around that. And part three is a follow-up of the cue card round, wherein the examiner will be asking you questions similar to the topic that was there in the part two. All right. So I've been really fast while explaining all of these because we're short on time, and I'm really, really impressed by all the 500 people that are there with us. And, you know, it's almost 10 and you guys are here surpassing your dinner time and I don't know, sacrificing your sleep. So commendable job. If you're here so far, it means you're really, really passionate about moving abroad and studying abroad, pursuing your higher studies in a different country, which is very much appreciated. So good job, guys. Let's move ahead and see the scoring patterns. So reading scoring criteria. These are the criteria, so it starts from 2.5 band score. We shouldn't even look at this, and it goes up to 9 band score. However, since you are academic students, you guys just need about 6.5 or 7. So your range of correct answers should fall between 27 to 32, and that's it. you don't have to be an all India rank holder here. You don't have to score 9 in each. You don't have to go with that intention of topping this test. There is no list or there's no ranking done here. It's just a qualifying test. So if you want to study abroad, there's a minimum requirement that's given to you by your colleges or by your universities. You just have to fulfill that. Don't get emotional or senti. Okay, don't get senti on this. You don't have to top this or prove it to anyone. Just get the desired amount of band scores that are needed for that offer letter. So here it's somewhere around 27 to 32. So I would say let's aim for 32 at least, 32 to 35. And these are the lists of band scores corresponding to the correct answers. So out of 40, if you get 32, or even if you get 30 correct, you get a 7 band score, which is pretty decent and doable if you understand the strategies. Similar is the case with listening. It's slightly different from the scoring done in reading. Apart from that, same rule applies here. You don't have to top. You don't have to score 9 bands here. If you can do it, it's wonderful. But you should not strive for that and just get crazy that meko to bhai 40 on 40 chahiye. I have had conversations with students who are like, ma'am, mujhe 9 bands and all the 4 modules chahiye. So that's pretty ridiculous, and it's not even required. Okay, even if it's required, I'll understand. But for a study visa, you just need 6.5 to 7. That's it. All right. So for your 6.5 bands, you need to score about 26 in your listening. And for 7, it should be within the range of 26 correct answers to 31 correct answers. So I guess this is very much doable if you listen to podcasts, if you listen to different interviews on English news channels, you'll have this practice of listening to various accents. Watch news channels like BBC so that you get different accents, and that's I guess more than enough. So 26, if you have to score 26 right answers, it gives you a scope of 14 incorrect answers, if I'm doing the right maths. Okay, so just focus on scoring somewhere around 31. Okay, 31 to 32. So that should be your target score and not 40. Okay, if you can do that, again, I'm saying it's commendable, it's good, but you don't have to strive for that or go crazy for that. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, Harit, so if there are any specific questions that you want me to pick from the chat box, just let me know, because it's really difficult to go through all of them.
Not really. I think it's all good. So people all good? Know how to prepare.
So there are around 300 messages on my chat box.
Yeah, no worries. It's all good. Yeah.
All good. Okay, so next up is your writing parameters. Okay, so how is your writing scored? Your listening is scored in a very objective manner. Similar is the case with your reading. So reading and listening are objective in nature. If your answer is correct, it's correct. If it's incorrect, it's incorrect. Okay, there's no beach ka bandar wala situation here. If it's correct, it's correct. If it's incorrect, it's incorrect. That's the end of the story. However, in case of your writing and speaking, there's a lot of subjectivity. Now, writing is scored on 4 parameters. Here, these two are actually similar. We consider them one, but we've broken it down into 2. So there are 4 parameters on which your writing is evaluated. The first one is task achievement or task response. The second one is coherence and cohesion. The third one is lexical resource. The fourth one is grammatical range and accuracy. So basically, these are the 4 parameters that the examiner has in front of them in the form of a checklist, and they keep putting yes, no, or to a certain extent while they assess your task 1 as well as task 2. So they see whether the grammar is good, whether they're using appropriate vocabulary, whether the paragraphing is done properly or not, and is the student actually answering what the question is asking them to answer, or are they deviating from the topic? So all of that is taken into consideration before they give you that band score. And yet again, if you need a 6.5, this is coming from an IELTS examiner that I had a word with just a couple of days ago. So she told me that to get a 6.5 band, you don't have to write complex sentences. A lot of students would ask in the chat box, or I've heard it before from other students, that you need to write complex sentences, you need to write compound sentences and whatnot. That is if you're aiming for 7.5 or 7. If you're just aiming for 6.5, which is the cutoff for most of the students who want to study abroad, in that case, even if you write simple sentences with appropriate grammar, good vocabulary, which is like decent enough so that it's not very repetitive, you can easily get 6.5. A lot of the trainers that train you deviate you from to the level that they ask you to use collocations, use complexity and use different structures, which is not really required until and unless you want 7.5 or 8 bands in your writing. If you want that, definitely you need to focus on different sentence structures and different vocabulary and lexical resources. That's true. But you need to see aapka agenda kya hai. Aap karna kya chahte ho, what's the purpose? Why are you doing? Always have that why clear in your mind. Aap kyun IELTS de rahe ho? Aapne top karna hai, do you have to prove it to someone? Or do you want to just go to the country and get your offer letter, which would come even if you get a 6.5? Be clear on why you want to take the IELTS test and why you want to study abroad as well. Okay, so I'll be just giving you a brief of each of the parameters. Ki ye hote kya hai, what each one of them mean. So task achievement is basically used for task one, whether you have interpreted the diagram, the pie chart or line graph or bar graph appropriately. Jo dikhaya gaya hai kya aap usko apne shabdon mein, are you able to express it properly in your own words or not? So that's the thing that they're looking at here. So what do they check in this? Presenting accurate information. Are you giving information that is being shown, or are you adding something from your own behalf? Number two, providing an overview. Are you telling the crux that you see from the image or bar graph hai or the pie chart that you see? Highlighting key feature stages. You need to highlight and compare. So you need to show what's the highest, what's the lowest, what's in the middle range, and then compare. Supporting details with data. So you need to also support whatever you're saying using the information given in your picture or in your illustration. That's for task one. Task two is, for task two, which is your essay writing, you need to ensure that you're addressing the task. The question might have, the essay question might be broken into two questions or might have two sub questions, and they might ask you about your opinion or they might ask you about the advantages and disadvantages. So whatever the question is asking you to do, are you doing that or are you just deviating from the topic? So you need to answer that. So addressing the task is the first thing that they see. Then giving relevant main points which are supported and developed. So it's very important to support your ideas. Okay, if you just randomly go to your parents and say that I want to go to Canada, and then they ask you why, you have no answer. Kya fayda hua? If you have no justification of why you want to do something that you want to do, or why you're taking this, taking a certain opinion in some essay, you will never be able to elaborate your points in the body paragraph. So here also, you need to have some relevant points to support your opinion. If you're saying, I agree to something, you need to have opinions to support that. If you're saying you're disagreeing to something, you need to have similar opinions for disagreement as well to justify your stance. So that needs to be elaborated and supported with examples. Then you have to give a clear position whether you're agreeing or disagreeing, and then ultimately provide a conclusion to whatever you've said in the essay. Next, the second parameter is coherence and cohesion. Here they're checking your ideas. Are you organizing the information appropriately, or is it haphazard? Is it like going haywire and there's no link between different points? It's very confusing to understand. Is it like that? If so, you'll be scored lesser. But if it's logical sequencing of ideas and you are ensuring that you're using cohesive devices properly, linking words such as however, moreover, more, then you'll be scored better. So using a range of linking devices. Okay. Lexical resource, more commonly known as vocabulary. So using a range of words and paraphrasing instead of repeating words again and again. So instead of repeating whatever you've already written or borrowing words from your question, it's better that you showcase your vocabulary. The examiner there is sitting to check your writing and to notice different words that you've used from your own word bank. Okay, so don't borrow words from the question. Then ensure that there are no spelling mistakes and you avoid any sorts of errors with respect to vocabulary. So use the correct words. You should not be using complicated words and then messing up with the meaning. So meaning is more important. If you, you know, use a fancy word, use a complicated word, but then the meaning of that word is not something that is defining that sentence where you've used it in. So in that case, the entire meaning of the sentence goes for a six. Koi fayda nahi hai uska. So instead of using big words, it's better that you use right words, okay? Grammar is basically using correct sentence structures, tenses, punctuations, and avoiding any sort of error with respect to your articles, your prepositions. So just keep in mind the broader perspective of your grammar. Okay, so this is it with writing parameters. If you want to know anything in more detail, definitely you can visit our YouTube channel. Everything has been explained in detail, and apart from that, obviously we offer classes also, so if you want to enroll into them for further information, you can also do so. Speaking again is subjective, just like writing, so it also has four parameters. Two of them remain similar to what they were in the writing, which are lexical resources. So if you notice, it's same, lexical resources and GRA. So grammatical range and accuracy and lexical resources are repeated here. So these are the two common parameters for both speaking and writing. The different ones are fluency. How fluent are you while speaking? Are you fumbling? Are you searching, or are you struggling to use the right words to, or to find the right words? So fluency is that, and pronunciation is pronunciation. I mean, I don't really think I have to explain what pronunciation is. So you need to pronounce the words correctly so that the examiner can understand what you're saying. So quickly going through all of this, fluency means talking at length. You can talk for about 1 to 2 minutes at a stretch without, struggling for words or without using all of these fillers. So that's important. Talking without pauses or hesitations, that's what I just said. So these words should be avoided. Talking without self-correction. Yes, self-correction. When you're talking to someone in your daily life, even if you make certain mistakes, you don't go back and correct them, right? Only if they're major mistakes, then you can do them. Otherwise, don't go back. Oh, second sentence, maine gadbad kar di. That's not needed at all. So you just go with the flow and don't think of correcting yourself while you're speaking. And using linking words, able to be understood. Okay, this is fine. Lexical resources, again, range of words and paraphrasing, collocations, less common vocabulary. Use different words. Don't use complicated words. Use different words. Okay. Avoiding errors, grammar, using range of sentence structures, grammar tenses, avoiding errors. That's the same again, so I'm not explaining it. Pronunciation, able to be understood throughout the test. So your pronunciation should be such that the examiner does not struggle or does not have to pay a lot of attention to what you're saying. So that's important. Able to use intonation. So, you know, your voice modulation is very important. Where you're stressing something, where you're trying to put forth something important, then you stress on it. If there's something that you don't really want to stress on, you just go ahead with your same tone. So your tone should keep on changing. Accent does not affect understanding. So accent, yet again, I don't know if somebody has asked this question in the chat box or not, but this is one of the most commonly asked questions to me. Ma'am, accent matter karta? So is the accent important? Should I use American accent or should I use British accent? Use your Indian accent. Be natural. If you start thinking about the accent in your actual test, you'll forget what to say. You'll just keep focusing on your accent itself. So instead of focusing on your accent, focus on what you're saying. Focus on your expression. Aap kehna kya chahte ho? That's more important than how you're saying it or the tone in which, I mean, the accent in which you're saying it. So more important is your expression. Then accurate word and sound pronunciation, that's already covered. So these are the parameters on which they'll be scoring you. So yet again, to score 6.5 or 7 in speaking is easy, provided you follow the rules that the trainer is asking you to follow. Okay, fine. So that's it from my end. We'll have a discussion round now. So I'm not getting into any further details. This was just a very basic introduction to IELTS. If you guys have any questions, I'll be just taking them up right now. And Harit and Gautam, if you think there are any specific questions that I should be taking, just let me know. I'll answer those. Now I have 500 messages to read.
Yeah, just
okay. So there's one I noticed. Nadeem Dinesh has asked IDP or British Council. So doesn't matter. Both are the same. Both are conducting bodies. They just organize the test, and the paper is actually made by the Cambridge University. So the papers, or basically the material or the content or the questions that you get, are same whether you're going for IDP or British Council. The only difference would be in the dates and the venue, and also how they administer the test. So that's very basic difference. Otherwise, when it comes to the question papers, the content, the difficulty level, everything remains the same. There's nothing that's different between the two. So I would recommend, while you're choosing whether you should be going for IDP or BC, the only thing that should be going on in your head is whether the venue is closer by closer when it's conducted by IDP or BC, and which one of these two are giving you better dates. Okay, so focus on your date and venue.
There's a query about computer-delivered test versus paper-based test.
Okay. Yet again, it's pretty similar to IDP and British Council. So just like IDP and British Council have the same question paper, have the same difficulty, and everything is the same. Apart from that, these are two different organizations. Similarly, in case of your paper-based or computer-delivered, the question paper remains the same in both the tests. The difficulty level remains the same in both the tests. All that changes is the mode of administration. In PBT or paper-based test, you're basically using pen and paper, which is a very conventional way of taking your test. So we have already been doing that for over, I would say, 15 years now, like 12 years of our school, and somewhere like 3 years of our bachelor's, we've been, you know, using pen and paper to answer all the exams. Similarly, here, you'll be doing that. However, in the case of computer delivered, it's using your computer. You will have to type your answers instead of writing it on a sheet of paper, and your reading and listening will also be on computer screens. So that's the basic difference. Apart from that, just one difference prevails in the CDT, which is that in your paper-based test, you have 10 extra minutes to transfer your answers from your listening test to your answer sheet. However, you don't get these 10 extra minutes in your computer-delivered test. So you have to do it simultaneously there. And in the case of your paper-based test, you can write it on your question paper initially, and then you can fare it out in the last 10 minutes on the answer sheet that is separately given to you.
Yes, Emma, without IELTS or TOEFL, you cannot get into any Canadian university. A lot of people are asking that how many attempts do we have? You have unlimited attempts, but the test costs 14,000 rupees. So I would recommend to get it done in the very first attempt itself, prepare for it well and get it done. And Pujasri is asking, Purvangi is asking, do we need to take IELTS after studies as well? Absolutely. Right now you will take IELTS academic for your studies, and later on you need to take IELTS general training for your permanent residency in Canada. And all right, okay, so I think Sanjita, let's wrap up the writing session. You can introduce the course that we were talking about, and then we will pass on the session to Gautam.
All right. So adding on to what Harit just mentioned, this is not just it. You'll have to take the IELTS test again for your PR process if you want to become a permanent resident. So if you learn something right now, you'll be able to implement it in the future also. So right now, whatever you're preparing, prepare from the context that it will help you out in the long run, be it your studies in Canada or any other country for that matter, and also for your PR process. So because you have to take your IELTS test again, which was the IELTS general training, which is pretty similar to your academic itself. So if you focus well and understand what the IELTS examiner is requiring out of you in the IELTS test, then you can implement it in the future as well for your general training test. So yeah, that's kind of about it. And there's a good news for you guys. So we are offering a Super 50 batch. We're launching it, in fact. So the Super 50 batch is exclusively for the IELTS academic students. So the ones who are on the webinar, I'm pretty sure all of you are going to appear for the academic test. And here, what do we offer in the Super 50 batch? So first of all, we'll only be taking 50 students. So that's the limit of the batch. It would be 50 serious students targeting overall 6.5 plus. So even if you want to score 7 or 7.5, you can still join this course. But a minimum of 6.5 is what you want to achieve, then this course is for you. Guaranteed improvement, sure shot improvement. There's no second thought to it. You'll definitely see a change in how you were scoring in all the four modules, be it listening, reading, writing, or speaking. Regular intensive live classes. We'll be having live classes on Zoom or any other similar platform wherein it would be interactive. We'll be asking you questions and you'll also be counter questioning us. So it's going to be a very interactive session. And then we'll be offering you 96 practice tests, which would include all the PDF files of the Cambridge book. Along with that, the bonus is that each one of the students would get 2 speaking mock tests with trainers. These would be one-to-one. This would not be a group class. It would be one-to-one. So it would be similar to the test, speaking test that would be conducted by the IELTS. Okay, so here there would be one trainer and a student, and the trainer would ask questions to the student will have to answer. And in the end, the trainer would tell them what are their mistakes based on the 4 parameters that we discussed, which were fluency, pronunciation, lexical resources, and cohesion and coherence. All right, so we'll be doing that. Last but not the least, we will be using the examiner's checklist. So this is something that's not really available publicly. This is kind of a secret checklist that only the examiners have. So as I mentioned in the beginning, if you were attentive enough, I told you that there's a checklist that they use for writing and speaking, and they put a tick mark if they see that, okay, you're using that particular factor. So they'll put yes. If you're not using it, they'll tick on no. And if you're using it to a certain extent, they'll put a tick on.
Vinith and Jinkia, please do not spam. Please do not spam, okay? So let me, answer your queries. So yes, IELTS will affect your chances of scholarship if you have a bad score. And Vinith is asking, how many months do we need to apply before? You can apply even 2 days before the test. It depends upon when the IELTS date is available. Okay, please do not spam. It's a humble request. Thank you.
Okay, so for the next 24 hours from now, you are getting a discounted price for this course. It is otherwise for $5,999. And if you register for it or enroll for it within next 24 hours, in that case, you will be getting this particular course for $3,999. All right, so that's it from my side. It's a pretty comprehensive course. Will include everything, all the 4 modules, all the 4 skill sets, listening, reading, writing, speaking, plus you'll get mock tests, and you'll also get your essays and both your task 1 and task 2 evaluated from us. So that's pretty much from my end. I'll be passing the baton to now Gautam Mittal. So he is, I don't have to introduce him again. I'm pretty sure Harit has done it really well. But if you want to apply for your visa, he's the person to go to. He's the most trusted one from my end. So Over to you, Gautam Mittal.
Okay, thank you, Sanjita. So people have queries regarding visa, whether we'll get this visa at this time in the COVID scenario. Yes, Canada has done a lot. They have bifurcated the process into two parts, like they are giving you approval in principle so that you guys can study very well while sitting in India or wherever you are. But yes, definitely the time has increased for the visa processing. It has increased to 20 weeks, like business days in 20 weeks. So technically what's gonna happen, I'm looking at the chat box earlier, people were asking whether we can join in January or in September 2021. At this moment, you can definitely join the courses in 2021 January, but definitely in September 2021, there are no such a window where you can apply for the courses in Canada, because they open all the courses 6 months before you can apply, right? So for visa, what technically we need? First, you need a proper base. Like whatever you have learned in India or wherever you are, you should apply into the same course. There should not be some, different courses you are choosing in Canada or in India. Like if I'm like Sanjita has done her course in accounting, then she has to enroll for accounting. If you'll go for basic other general studies course, there are possibilities you will not get the visa, right? And second thing, you need an overall score of 6 bands for student visa to wait a minute, there's some query. Can we apply for visa before the completion of? There is no such thing like you can apply any visa before the completion of your course, because to get the admission in the college, you need to complete your course and then get the IELTS done and get the course admission done. After that, we can apply for your visa, right? And what people were asking about the SOPs and LOR. SOPs are the statement of purpose on the basis of which you can apply. Like, what is your intent to come to Canada or to any other country? If whether you are coming for PR or whether you are coming for studies, basically statement of purpose means you are telling the visa officer to why you are coming and what you want to achieve through studies, right? And letter of recommendations, that is required for those students who have less percentage in the studies, so that they can improve their file. We can improve the overall filing thing, right? And for the PR thing, now I'll come to PR visas. We need 8777 band for PR visa, first thing. Second thing, we need bare minimum balance of 6 to 7 lakhs for a single person to get the PR and this is the basic which we need for filing a visa. And now if you have any queries regarding any visa thing or any queries regarding coming to Canada, what you'll do after coming to Canada, you can ask me that. Okay, how to get letter of recommendation? You can get letter of recommendation from your current employer, from your college. You can ask the principal or teacher. You can get the letter of recommendation from them, right? Ruchika is asking, can we do part-time job? Yes, on student visa, you can do part-time job, definitely. And Vishal is asking about minimum amount required for GIC. It is $10,200, which is the minimum requirement. What about the course? How long? It's taking 5 to 6 months as of now for the visa processing, but definitely before visa processing, Canadian government is giving AIP, which is approval in principle, through which you can study in Canada, right? Now, there is one more point I want to highlight about, like, to get the post-grad work permit, you need to study
more than 50% in Canada. Right now, people have query if they'll start studying in India or in their respective country, they'll not get the post-grad work permit. Yes, that is there. We need to join in January. We need to take admission in January. And hopefully, Canadian government and colleges are working on this thing that students from the different countries can come and study here. So even if we take the admission in January and we get our visa processed or get our AIP in time, we can start studying in January till April. And I believe, and as per the people here, as per IRCC, everybody is going to get the visa before April and they can travel to Canada. Okay. Is it compulsory to get 8777? Yes, it is compulsory, because without 8777, you will not be able to score good in CRS. Like at this moment, 478 is the cutoff which is going on. So to reach to 478, we need to have 8777 bands. And 8777 means in listening, you need 8 bands. In writing, in speaking, in reading, you need 777. And IELTS should be, you should complete your IELTS as soon as possible. That is the must thing. To get the admission in universities, you need to have IELTS. For colleges, you can go with Duolingo also. I think Sanjita, Harit, you know it, na?
Yeah.
Okay. So can you work in student visa while doing masters? Yes. You can absolutely work while you are having student visa. It's like you can work only 20 hours a week. That's the must. No, don't go beyond that. As Canadian government and immigration people are keeping a check on the students, whether they're working 20 hours or more. You can work in bachelor's. When you have a student visa, you can work here. That's the simple. And with the IELTS general, at this moment, you can apply, but definitely you require IELTS academic for applying Canadian visa. Again, Vineet, it is taking 5 to 6 months for visa processing, but they are giving AIP in advance so that you can start studying. What kind of getting the
offer? Nice. So there are some students asking about offer letters. So offer letters, it depends upon the college to college, but overall I think that if you're targeting January 2021, just get in touch. I have provided you the number. I've also just dropped an SMS to everyone attending the webinar about, you know, all the details about the number and how you can consult us. So just get in touch with me. Generally the offer letters comes in 3 weeks, not more than that, 3 to 4 weeks. Sabha, first you get your admission and then you can get your visa. You cannot get your visa without an admission. You get your admission, you pay the fee, then you show the visa officer that I am a student, please give me the visa. That's how it is.
So the process is, first you have to get the admission, the offer letter from the college. You have to pay the fees to the college to get the letter of acceptance. After that, we pay the GIC, which is $10,200. And after, when you complete this process, we initiate your visa filing. For the visa filing, we need your graduation certificates, your plus two certificate, your 10th certificate, then this letter of acceptance, GIC account. And then we see if you guys have low scores in your academics, we definitely recommend you to get letter of recommendations from your current employers, from the business owners, or from the principal, or from the teacher from where you have studied. That is must if you have scored less in your academics, right?
GIC is concerned, so a lot of people are asking about blocked accounts. So GIC is a blocked account in which you deposit $10,000 and every month you get certain part of it back as pocket money. So this $10,000 you get back. And Lalita asking about dentistry. Lalita, you can always go for an MDS. But before that, the thing is that you can only pursue an MDS in Canada or anywhere else once you're a recognized dentist here, right? So to get recognized in Canada, you need to come to Canada and take an exam. I'm forgetting the name, I apologize, but it's a very expensive and a very difficult exam. So what students generally do after dentistry is they go for courses like healthcare administration or healthcare management. They join that course, then do their dentistry equivalency, and then they start practicing as a dentist. Ankur, it's the same story for MBBS as well, something that I mentioned.
Nandigam, we don't require 8777 for university admission. And this is, who is this? Vineet.
The validity of IELTS is 2 years, so you can take it anytime, but make sure, you know, just keep in mind that if you're starting your course in September 2022, don't take it right now. By the time you will start your course, your IELTS will expire, right? So generally, you should make sure that your IELTS is active on your course start date.
There is some person who is asking about, I have my final exams in September. I have still not taken IELTS. So just this guy, just take Duolingo and get
a college offer letter.
Get your admission done. And after that, we can apply your visa before October 15th. And you are good to go for January intake, because at this moment, colleges have opened January intake only. There are very few colleges who have opened this April intake at this moment. Will there be issue in visa? If you have done your master's, go for master's. Don't go for post-graduation diploma. There will be an issue. If visa officer will be strict, you will not get the visa, because you have to really justify why you want to do post-grad diploma rather than going for master's if you have already completed your master's. There are so many universities, Shivani, who offers co-op in Jan intake also. So you can connect with Harit regarding that, definitely. And Bhargav, you can apply for visa if you have a offer letter for Jan intake, definitely, that is sure. After BBA, Nandan, you should go for MBA. If you don't want to go for MBA, go for Masters in Finance. That'll be good. Or Masters in Economics. That'll be really good if you want to pursue in... Oh God, there are 410 messages. Harit, if you can answer a few, because my chat box is hanged.
So if someone is asking what is better, Montreal or Toronto, see every place better.
I'll say Toronto. I'll definitely go with Toronto. Montreal, you need French. Yes. You need to learn French.
So you're
asking Montreal, definitely.
What is better, say Gurgaon or Mumbai? You know your answer, right?
And
what's better. Okay, so how much do we charge for the whole package? See, we don't charge anything for our educational consultancy. It's absolutely free since we represent the colleges. So we have a good relationship with the colleges. They keep us happy. We keep our students happy. So there is no charge for the educational consultancy. But at times when you apply to a particular college, there's an application fee that we pay for you. So you might have to just pay that. All right. So best time to enroll for September 2021. At least get your IELTS done. The reason behind that is that for September 2021, the deadlines will open from October or November. So take benefit of the early bird deadlines. Can we wait? So is it TRE which we can't PhD? Is it true that we can't do PhD after master's non-thesis? Yes, Sheetal. As far as PhD is concerned, it totally depends upon which PhD you want to do and if you are able to find a professor to supervise you. If that professor is convinced, you can get a PhD, not an issue. But otherwise, thesis, non-thesis doesn't matter. It depends upon how well you can convince the professor who you want to work under or who you want to supervise. What happens when we pay the fee and visa gets rejected? Very good question. What happens if you pay all the fee, all the GIC and the visa gets rejected? So obviously it comes back as a refund. All right. Everything comes back as a refund. You lose around $200-$250 for the visa processing fee of college, but everything comes back. Okay. advanced college diploma is not equal to graduate certificate. Graduate certificate is after bachelor's. Advanced college diploma is before bachelor's. If we don't get visa, university fee will be wasted. No, not at all. VFX has amazing demand in Canada, Pavan, everywhere. In fact, there are a lot of gaming, game development companies in Canada. So yes, obviously this has a very good demand. Manasvi, I think you should take IELTS straight away because take benefit of the early bird deadline. If at 10th, 12th, we scored less in graduation, we scored well.
By internet 10.
No, Purvangi, I don't think it should be a problem if your 10th and 12th score was weak. Okay. If your bachelor's score is good now, postgraduate diploma and visa won't be an issue. IELTS, TOEFL or GRE, which one should I give? Nishant is asking. Nishant, so let's understand it like this. If you want to study in US and particularly in a very good university and that too in technical field, you have to take GRE. Done. If you want to study in US but you do not want to study in a technical degree and you want to go for like a normal degree that many universities and colleges don't require GRE, then take TOEFL. If you want to study in Canada, take IELTS. You don't need GRE or TOEFL for Canada. How much does it cost for a student visa? Ruchika, there are two costs. The first cost is your student fee, tuition fee, which is generally around $14,000 to $16,000 per year. And you have to pay 1 year tuition fee. And beyond that, there's a GIC of 5.6 lakh rupees, around $10,000. This comes back to you, but you should plan a ballpark figure of 15 lakh rupees. Is it worth going for media? Absolutely, Anutra. What is life without media? Digital media, print media, this media, that media, everything is very important. So digital media marketing and all these things have a very good demand. Yes, Mizbah, take it in the third year. I would recommend. Otherwise, it will get expired by the time you will go. Ansh, open or online classes for January 21. It depends upon the college to college, but most of the colleges will be online. But get in touch with me if you have a particular course in mind. We might be able to find a college that is offering offline classes. What about best time for spring 2021? Palak, it's the best time. Some of the best colleges in Canada have already opened up and they close very soon. So, you know, you should go for it. Masters in Human Resource Management, Shanaika, there's no Masters in Human Resource Management. There's an MBA in HR. Okay. That's how it is. So there's a spammer, Nishant. Oh my God, I have answered him. Project management graduate certificate. Yes, Palak, a lot of options are available in project management. So just get in touch with me. I will be able to help you. Can we get amount for blocked account from education loan? Ganesh, if you are going for a government bank, they will not be giving you education loan for GIC. Private lenders like HDFC, Credila and Avance will be giving you education loan. How many days required for IELTS results? Computer delivered test results come out in 5 days and the paper-based test results come out in 13 days. All right. What about GIC in case funding through loan? I answered that, Abhishek. Private lenders can fund your GIC as well. So what is the reputation of, what is the reputation of Langara College? So
Langara College, I'll tell you, I am a student of Langara College. Specifically, I'll not recommend you going to that college because they're not flexible at all. You will end up losing money going to Langara College. Better go to Douglas. They are more specific to the course. Langara will teach you the, I'll say, overall general course rather than be specific to the particular particular course line. Like I did one accounting course. They taught me statistics and everything. But if you'll go to Douglas, they will teach you the softwares on which you actually gonna work.
Right. So
go for that.
Manasvi is asking, is there any employment rate for aerospace engineering? Manasvi, let me ask you a question. Is there a good employment rate of aerospace engineering in India? You will have the answer, right? The job market works the same everywhere, right? Aerospace engineers are rare and so are the jobs. Right. So for that reason, you need to excel. You really need to work hard to be able to, you know, do well. So as we promised that we will be bringing an international student as well. So Mr. Tegbir has joined us, who happens to be an international student. And he got some of his college admissions done through us when he's already in Canada. So I thought of inviting him to address some of your queries related to living in Canada. Okay, so we have already discussed how to choose a course. We have discussed how to crack IELTS. We have discussed what are some things that are important for a visa. Now let's talk about how do you live in Canada. Okay, so please, you know, keep your questions limited to living in Canada now. All right, so for example, what is the cost of living, whether I can get part-time jobs or not. So Tegvir is showing a scenery on where he's driving right now. Canada College is good. It's not a bad college, right?
Hi, guys. Hello. Sorry, I was not able to listen to you earlier.
No worries. So as you can notice, as soon as a person goes to Canada, his accent changes as well. Right. So guys, you can ask your queries to Tegbir related to life in Canada. How much is the cost of a meal there, Tegbir? Question number one.
Okay.
That I can answer very well. If you are living in Surrey or Brampton, you will get tiffin service.
Yeah, depends like what... like how lavishly you want to eat. So khana to free mein milta, gurudwara chale jao yaar. Again, so it's all depends on your pocket.
Questions coming?
What you want to afford, it's all depends on you, man. So it's from nothing to anything. So but on general, one time meal like for friends going out, like $20 per head, I would say, and monthly groceries if you're doing it, costs you like $100-$120.
Okay, take me. So just, you know, on an average, tell me if there's a student who is, you know, who has decided to study in Canada, how much cost of living should he plan on a monthly basis?
If you are trying to live like a very substantial,
let's say an
economical,
average student.
I hope the middle class is not having a car here. So $600.
Okay. $600. Okay. So that's like,
so whatever your GIC amount is, it's basically thought of that should be how much you should sustain for a month.
Okay.
If you don't work. Yeah.
All right. So Nishant is asking, is $1,000 enough for a month? Yes, Nishant, I think it's more than enough.
Yeah, yeah.
But sharing your room with someone. Right? Yes.
Yeah. We also have one more guest with us.
I'll answer Tosif's query. What are the common reasons for a visa rejection? Tosif, visas are getting rejected because you have not filed your visa file properly, or there is a gap in your studies. Like you have 10 years of experience and now you want to study. Then you have to really justify why you want to come to Canada. Or there are different courses. Like in India, you have done accounting. Here, you want to come to medical line. These are the reasons, basically. And you are not able to justify them.
Tegbir, what is the status of part-time jobs? So Tegbir has already completed his Bachelor's of Engineering in India. So Tegbir, how difficult was it for you to find a part-time job?
So before I answer that, I would like to introduce my friend. She's mm-hmm. sitting with me right now. We're both traveling. So she will also be answering with me some of the questions. So guys, Sharon, do you want to just say hi?
Hi, guys.
So.
Hi, Harith.
Yeah, hi, Sharon. How are you?
I'm good. I hope all of you are good. We are here to answer all of your questions today. I'm really excited.
So for students who are going to Conestoga College, I'll tell you that you must have seen Sharon before. In the international transition meetings, if anybody has attended them, you can recognize this face. But if you don't, then I'll tell you what Sharon is doing. Sharon, you should tell what you're doing.
Yeah,
that would be more better.
I am actually in my college. I help students with their transition and their, like, all these general questions what you have, like about life in Canada, how much does it cost for a meal, and all of that. So this is what like my job is in Canada. Okay. So like I share my experiences and I really love doing that because like when I was new to this place, I had so many questions in my head, just like all of y'all. And then it's nice to talk to someone who's been through that way, right?
Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. So Sharon,
now coming to the question which you asked,
yeah,
the part-time jobs. So are we only focusing on Conestoga College students, or it's like everybody?
We are focusing broadly on Canada.
Broadly, okay. So,
yeah.
See, I only know Ontario, and I would say if you're closer to Toronto GTA area, or if you are in bigger cities, then it's pretty easier as compared to if you go to north. By north, I mean like Sudbury, North Bay, Sault Ste. Marie, all those places. Over there, it's a little difficult because it's very seasonal. All jobs are pretty seasonal. They depend on like if there are winters, then definitely you will get very less jobs. But during summertime, it's the peak time and you get a lot of work there. But in these areas, GTA areas, Kitchener, I'm from Waterloo, so Kitchener-Waterloo area has a lot of jobs. There are a lot of industries here, all sorts of industries. And they keep on hiring people, and then there's always a huge demand for labor jobs. And so part-time job is pretty good, but there's always that 1 or 2 months of struggle that you have to go through and prepare resumes and meet people, make some references. That's the only key here.
Nate is asking, can we do campus jobs and part-time jobs together?
Oh yeah, definitely. Me and Sharon both have been doing campus jobs. I think both years we did.
Yeah, so we've been doing campus jobs, like that was also part of our journey. And that allows us to work 20 hours on campus, and we can also work 20 hours off campus.
Yeah.
So Nadine has asked a wonderful question. I think that this question is the closest to my heart as well. How difficult is it to manage the cold?
The cold, oh.
Okay, so this thing I would like to answer because, see, I am coming from a tropical place. I have never been exposed to winters at all. So in my city, it would always stay 24, 25 and never lesser than that or the more. So when I was exposed to minus 50, like in the first place, like trust me, it is very hard only when you are outside. You know what I mean? Like when you're waiting for a bus or when you are like directly exposed to outside, but otherwise in a building, in a car, in a bus, or the place where you work, everywhere it's like they have the temperature controller and everything, so it's all good. Like you will be able to manage. It's not like you cannot manage. If minus 50 is something like you would never think of, but if I could survive, you could all survive. Don't worry, guys.
Yeah.
So on an average, Tausif is asking, "Sidhi baat karo yaar." On an average, how much can a student earn in a month doing a part-time job?
Bro, wahi main keh raha hu na ki everything depends on what you want from what you want to do in Canada. Agar tum padhne yahan aa rahe ho, then I would say don't work more than 20 hours. Okay.
So,
and if you work, the if one you work 20 hours,
thing is that as far as the legalities are concerned, you're allowed to work only 20 hours a week. Okay. But a lot of students work beyond 20 hours, which is something that I highly do not recommend.
Not recommend. Yeah.
Not at all. Because see, end of the day, you are spending, I will repeat myself, you are spending lakhs and lakhs of rupees not to go there and work in part-time job. You are going there to build a career, and you can only build a career if you are focusing on your studies. So let's say if a good student is working, you know, if a sensible student is working for 20 hours a week, on an average, how much will he make in a month?
So 20 hours a week, then he can make average $1,000.
Okay. $1,000.
Yeah.
So let's say that
it also depends on some sort of job. Like the minimum wage is $14 in Ontario, right? So some jobs tend to pay like 16 or 17, depending on what job you have. And some jobs also give you some tips. Like if you work in restaurants, you also, like students also tend to earn a lot of tips. So that would maybe, let's say, it might sum up to 2,200 or 300.
With 20 hours, it's like 1,200-ish.
What about the, Ronak is asking, what about the seasonality of the jobs?
So there are some jobs which are like, they go throughout the year, like grocery stores, petrol stations, right? But there are some jobs which are seasonal. Let's say I've done pretty funny jobs, you know. So there was one job which I did. I was working at the for Halloween party once, and I used to scare people for like 1 week. So it was very, very funny. Like, you would get the costumes and then you would just have to like jump in front of people, scare them, right? So that's the thing. Like, in Christmas, you get those kind of jobs. Like, you get hired for, let's say, just small terms. Some local vendor wants to sell.
So there's a question coming from Mr. Singh, as expected. What's the hourly wage for truckers?
Truckers... वैसे मैं इस फील्ड च है नहीं, सॉरी, मेनू इस बारे ज्यादा नॉलेज नहीं हैगी, बट माय फ्रेंड्स हु ड्राइव इट, दे मेक प्रीटी गुड मनी, प्रीटी गुड.
सो गौतम वांट्स टू से समथिंग.
मोर देन अ डेवलपर, आई वुड से
सॉफ्टवेयर डेवलपर, यू वुड मेक मोर मनी एज अ ट्रकर. वेरी नाइस.
या
दैट्स इंटरेस्टिंग. गौतम, आई थिंक यू आर म्यूटेड, अनम्यूट
योरसेल्फ. या विद ट्रकर यू कैन अर्न अ लॉट, लाइक यू हैव सो मेनी बेनिफिट्स. You get the refund from the government, and your pay rate is usually more than $20. If you have good experience, it goes up to 25 to 30 with an Indian owner trucking company. So
Nadeen is asking you, so it's better to be a trucker than a developer? No, Nadeen, never.
No, never, because you will be on road and weather is harsh.
I won't say it's a good or bad. It's a personal choice. Some people want to be developers, some people want to be truckers. So every profession is good, but it's just to you, like what you want to do, do whatever you want to do.
Right. So, a lot of people are asking that, can I do part-time jobs and sustain my cost of living? So I will tell you what a standard cost of living in Canada looks like, right? If you do not own a car, first of all, I think that accommodation, when you are living with someone, when you are sharing it with someone, it costs you $300 to $350 for the room at an individual level. The groceries are around $200 per month. And I think the other costs, like your mobile phone, you're going to Canada, how can you stop yourself without buying the latest iPhone, right? So the cost of that, the data plan and all those things, I think it all comes down to $650, $700. And you make around $1,000, $1,100 in your part-time job. So you can somewhat, be at least assured that I will be able to pay my cost of living. So Tegbir, what about on campus and off campus stay?
Stay on campus is expensive.
Right.
And and usually the campus is a little away from the city, from the downtown. Some of them are. So it's very difficult for you to commute from that place to your workplace. So mostly students will usually go for shared places where they'll rent an apartment or a house and then share the place. And by that, you save a lot of money. And also you can choose that place based on your job, like where your job is, and then those kind of things. So it gives a lot of flexibility, and it saves a lot of money if you are outside the college.
The campus. A very important one. As a student, whatever I earn, do I have to pay tax on that? Oof.
The indirect taxes, though, everybody pays, but the direct tax, no. The government will refund you that when you do your income tax filing. So the government gives you that money back.
Okay.
That's so, just the income tax, not CPP and tax. EI. There are two more deductions in your pay stubs in salary.
So if you are not taking care of these things, please get in touch with Gautam as soon as possible.
Gautam, good to know. Yeah, thank you. Like, I'm not good at these things, but Gautam definitely is the boss.
So the last question for the day, it was a long comprehensive webinar, right? I hope that you all liked it. Last question for the day, Tegbir and Sharon. Purvangi is asking, what's the first thing that a student should do when stepping in Canada?
First, you should go to your hotel or where you have to go. And after that, next day, you have to apply for the SIN, which is the most important thing.
Right.
Without SIN, you won't be able to work. And get After getting your SIN, you have to open the bank account in which you have opened your GIC account so that you can start getting GIC. And on the very first, you will get $2,000 out of $10,000 whenever when you'll open your GIC, your bank account so that you can have good amount in your hand to start your living.
Okay. Great. So there are some interesting questions as well. But I think that, you know, we need to wrap it up. It's almost 2 hours now. I need to have my dinner. And I think all of us, you know, are sitting like,
and yes, I have to go for a meeting at 11.
Yeah. Right. So I hope that you guys liked this session. Right. So I have already sent a message with the link to the IELTS Academic Crash Course and the link and my mobile number on which you can get in touch with me and talk about your. So there's another guy, Papa Ji, who is saying that are din ka 7000 se 8000 marketing business Canada chake kya karoge. Theek hai apna, you know, Papa Ji, so we will definitely get in touch with you. Apologies, hum ya galat jagah aa gaye. So all right guys, so thank you very much. I hope that this was a good session for you guys. I hope you guys got a lot of clarity. So thank you very much. The numbers,
yeah. Let's take a feedback poll, please, so that we get to know, reflect upon how we did and what should be the improvements like for the future.
So on a scale of 1 to 10, please write down how well would you
rate. Read the poll, right, Harit?
I will not be able to do that. So that time. No. Okay. So we have 10. Oh my God. Great. 8. Great. So the people who are not giving us a 10, please write to us what you didn't like, right? So I hope that this was an informative session. I hope that this makes your investment of lakhs of rupees, your emotions, a lot of things valuable. Okay. So thanks a lot, guys. And good night. Wishing you all the very best for your careers. Do get in touch with us for your consultancy related to studying abroad, IELTS, or anything, any doubt that you have. Okay. We will be able to help you out and assist you in the same. So thank you very much. Thank you for sticking around and have a very, very, very good night ahead. Sanjita, please.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Kavir and Sharon, for coming. So thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dekbir.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, Gautam.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. It was a lovely session. Thank you, Gautam. Thank you, Harit. And I hope you guys know that each one of us specializes in one field. So we make a good team. So for IELTS, you can reach out to me. For taxation related and visa related issues, you can reach out to Gautam, sir. And for your admission counseling related queries, we have Harit with us. So yeah, Gautam, you were saying
they can join me for any Canada related inquiry after they come to Canada, or if they have any query when they'll arrive to Canada, I can address that.
And definitely. Just in case if you guys don't know,
and there is one guy, 50% in graduation is okay for Canada. Yes, it depends. That is what we were trying to say, that you need to get letter of recommendations from your college so that we can have a good SOP ready for the visa officer that you really want to study. That's the thing. Harit?
Yeah. All right.
So
guys.
You can, yeah.
Thanks a lot.
And guys. Share all. Thank you.
Yeah. So I will send you all the emails and everything in a little while. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You have to close it, Harit.
Sanjita, end the meeting. Sanjita?
Can you
My system is hanged.